good morning, everybody. So I hope you guys have come here to listen to an interesting talk first up in the morning. But unfortunately, identity management is not a very interesting topic. If you take the theory, there are lots and lots of specs related to identity management. It's a pile of specs. But don't worry, I'm not going to talk about specs here today. So my objective in this talk is to just to show you where the world of identity management is kind of heading towards, and how the WSO2 identity server, how we are kind of aligning our product to that direction, how we are aligning our features and components to that direction. So how has the past been when it comes to identity and access management? So there we have heard of a lot of specs. There has been OpenID, SAML2SSO, XACML for access control, OpenID Connect, then OAuth for API security, so many profiles of OAuth, some still at draft stages, some have become a standard, some are going through numerous iterations. So there is a lot of hype around this identity management space, right? But what is our approach? We don't want to get caught into the hype, right? I think yesterday also Sanjeev mentioned in the keynote, we want to take a step back and look what are these specifications trying to solve, right? What is the problem, what is the use case the specification is trying to solve, right? So our implementation is not a specification-driven implementation. It's more of a use case-driven implementation, right? If today we implement, let's say, OAuth, tomorrow OpenID Connect, day after tomorrow we implement UMA or some other new specification, it's very isolated, right? So we need an integrated story, right? So we look at what the use case it's trying to solve, and we see how it integrates with our internal features that we already have in the product, how it connects, how the connected story comes out, and also how it integrates with our other products, our alternative products, our competitive products, complementing products, so on and so forth. So what are the key differentiators in a successful IAM product, right? So one is it should embrace strategy over tactics, right? So we should look at the long term, what it's trying to solve in the long term, rather than look at a very short term use case. And then rapid time to value and low operational costs. So typically we see a successful project with identity server, our customers are able to like go into like into production into 3 to 4 months, right? But it may depend when there are like specific use cases to be implemented, some custom components, then it may get delayed. But typically out of the box features, 3 to 4 months, our customers are successful in going into production. Right? Then access control is more of a business problem than IT problem. This is also a key important feature, important point. So when it comes to IAM, identity and access management, the audience is very different compared to other WSO2 products. If you take WSO2 ESB, WSO2 Application Server, DSS, BPS, the audience is more like developers, right? Those are service hosting products. It more falls into the category of a PaaS, right? But identity server, although it's if we call it another middleware product, it's more of an application or software application level product, which integrates with other applications. It's more of a SaaS, right? So the users of the identity server are also not always developers. It's more of sometimes business users, sometimes sysadmins. Those kind of users. So we need to cater to their requirements as well. And the deployment flexibility. So we need to be able to deploy the product in a public cloud, private cloud, hybrid cloud, on-premise, and the deployment migrations should be very easy and flexible. And also, the other philosophy is that we always follow minimal coding and more configuration-driven approach. So that is visible through all our products, from ESB to API Manager, whatever product you might have used in WSO2. So these are the three disrupting forces right now in the information security space, mobile, social, and cloud. And all these three forces bring their own challenges to security, right? So when we say mobile, we are talking about the various different devices that connect to any identity provider. So it can be mobiles, desktops, notebooks, tablets. So the problem with these devices are that it's not in your control. You don't own the device. It's outside your control. If we take cloud, what's different from cloud to an on-premise deployment, right? The on-premise deployment is within your organization. But when it comes to cloud, it's beyond your boundaries. So there also, again, there is a problem of controlling, right? It's an unknown thing. So then if you go to the social, we are talking about the users. So it's no more your internal employees, internal users. You're opening up your channels to, like, your customers, your partners, right? And leads, prospects, whatever it is, right? So there is more kinds of users coming in. So these three forces has a lot of effect when you design a good security solution for your organization. So why an IAM product such as WSO2 Identity Server might be a good fit when it comes to a cloud deployment, right? Number one, it's mostly a standardized product, so all the standards we follow, like open standards that are widely accepted. It's cost-effective, right? Extends the same security model that is on-premise to the cloud. So this model actually comes from our Carbon platform itself. So the cloud-native features and stuff are all built into the product. So the migration, or if you want to migrate from on-premise to cloud, there is no cost, and it's quite easy. So this is one of the key drivers for large organizations who have complex security policies to migrate to the cloud. And also, it can handle SaaS applications. So that's also another key feature with the multi-tenancy of products like Identity Server. So what is the challenge in the mobile space? So SSO has been a key challenge when it comes to native applications, right? We haven't had a standard solution up to now for mobile SSO. But now there is like work that is going on by the OpenID Connect Foundation, which is called Native Application Working Group, and they are actually developing a standard to do SSO between mobile applications. And in parallel, actually, WSO2, also inside WSO2, we have developed a similar kind of a mobile SSO agent, which is not actually conforming to this standard, but when we compare it, it both kind of go along the same lines. But once this is finalized, we will incorporate these improvements, these specifications to our product as well. Then dynamic client registration. So when talking about mobile, there is a lot of usage of OAuth. So in OAuth, we generate a client ID and a client secret. So what happens, this client ID and client secret, it's embedded in the mobile device, right? So if the mobile device is stolen, or you lose the mobile device, or if the application is compromised, this client ID and secret can be compromised. And not only the ID and secret of that particular application, but all the devices where that application is installed can be compromised. So there's another specification which says we have to generate the client ID and secret dynamically. And periodically, we need to regenerate it. So that's dynamic client registration profile, right? Then how do we store data in the client side, right? We all know we have to encrypt client side data, but how do we encrypt? What is the key we are going to use to encrypt? And then how do we secure the key securely? So that's another problem. And then we have the various type of devices, that is the bring your own device concept. I think our MDM solution is built to solve this kind of problem. So there are several concepts behind it, how to secure the device and how to provision, deprovision the devices. So when it comes to bring your own device concept, there are concepts such as desktop virtualization, OS containerization, app prepping, selective wipe. So these are some of the features our MDM product has. So what is the future of authentication looking like? So Gartner says a model called zero trust authentication. So what is zero trust authentication? So in earlier days, we used to sometimes trust certain users, like internal users coming from internal network, or like partners coming from specific networks that we know. In those cases, we don't authenticate those users. We trust and then verify. But Gartner says, in future, we won't be going for that kind of a model. We have zero trust. We will be authenticating each and every user, right? The levels of authentication might differ, but we will at least authenticate with the minimum level of trust and also give least privileges to the user to whatever resources he wants to access. If he needs more access to privileged resources, then he needs to elevate his access level. For that, you can go for options like multi-factor authentication, right? So multi-factor authentication is also quite common these days. Any website you go in the internet, if you need to share your personal information, personally identifiable information, you always see there are some strong two-factor authentication options available, right? So smartphones, key fobs, fingerprint, QR code scanner. These were all like non-standardized ways of authentication until we arrived to Fast Identity Online Alliance. So this is a new alliance, and they have developed a standard for multi-factor authentication. So they have developed a standard for the communication between the device, the chip, and the server, as well as basically the chip and the server, as well as the browser and the chip, how to read the chip. So these are two standards they have developed, and Identity Server has already implemented these two standards, and we are actually planning to release this with Identity Server 5.1.0. So along with this, in the multi-factor authentication space, we have also developed a time-based one-time password authentication. So this is also an IETF standard, a time-based one-time password authentication, similar to what you find in Google. When you want to do one-time password authentication to your Gmail, you get a code to your phone, and then you would use the Google Authenticate application to authenticate. So similar to that, we also have implemented that feature. And then we have written several connectors to third-party multi-factor authentication providers. For example, Duo Security is a third-party multi-factor two-step authentication provider which will send an SMS to your mobile phone, and then you can insert that PIN to the web application. So we have developed certain connectors for that as well. And then what happens with social login, right? So this is another interesting area. So the security experts are predicting that in future, we might not store the user identities, corporate identities, in our corporate LDAPs or corporate Active Directories. What they are expecting is there will be like a centralized repository, right, which is governed by like a trusted body, maybe the government of a country or something like that. And all the organizations will depend on that centralized repository for identity verification, right? So all your online transactions, all your service, all the services that you consume from websites, these will all rely on that central repository, right? And also people are mostly using the devices more than the PCs, the non-PCs, right? And people are using that to do personal work as well as professional work. So that might also need to go for this kind of a model. So but what they are saying is more of a consumer-driven approach, right? So every user is like a consumer. We can already see examples of this. So the National Strategy for Trusted Identities in Cyberspace is kind of an alliance in the US, which is kind of trying to govern all the identities, online identities of its users. We can find the same thing in UK as well, UK Government Identity Assurance Program. I think some of you guys might know about it. So they're also trying to come up with a central repository to govern all the citizens' online identity. And same thing, actually, the Dubai e-government, the Dubai Connect project, which is also powered by the WSO2 Identity Server, they're also doing the same thing to give access to their online services to their consumers. Then what about access control? So context-based access control. So Gartner actually predicts in 2016, more than 70 or 80% of access control will be context-based access control. And the only access control tool that we have is SACMAL, right? But some people believe that SACMAL is dead, right? Is SACMAL dead? It's not dead. The problem with SACMAL is it's a difficult language to learn, right? And the problem is who should define access control policies? It's mostly the business users who have to develop access control policies. But if you open the identity server, let's say for example, if you open the identity server, go to the SACMAL view, and if you want to define a simple business policy, it's not that easy. You have to learn SACMAL language. So this is where I think we made a mistake. We thought the end user would be a developer or person who can read and understand the SACMAL specification, but actually the end user is a business user. So we need to enable those business users to define policies, not like in SACMAL language, but in a different alternative way. And maybe in the back end, we can generate the SACMAL policy. So we need to enable and make it easy for the business users to apply the policies. So actually, SACMAL is not dead. There are a lot of usage in SACMAL. And due to this, there are a lot of customer demand also for SACMAL. And due to this, we are putting a lot of effort on this for our 5.2.0 release. And we are trying to come up with new features and revamp our UIs as well to improve the SACMAL support in WSO2IS. And of course, more compliance, PCI DSS, HIPAA, NIST, and so on. The Enterprise Identity Bus. So this is the concept we introduced last year, which got a lot of hype. So the main objective of this bus is to separate the service providers and the identity providers. So the applications and where the user authenticates. So the service providers don't need to know about all the identity providers. Identity providers no need to know about who are the service providers who are connecting to him. The identity server as a hub in the center will govern these connections. And also we know that the need for a universal standard is still a dream. It hasn't become a reality. Every day there are new standards coming up. So everyone is talking different protocols. So someone in the middle needs to mediate between these protocols. So that is also another function of the identity server. It is governing the connections as well as it is mediating between protocols. And also, we don't want to change the existing service providers or the identity providers. So this is mainly the key features of the Enterprise Identity Bus. So this is the architecture of the IS5. So the key components here related to the identity bus are the inbound authenticators. Then we have the inbound provisioning connectors. Then we have the outbound authenticators and the outbound provisioning connectors, right? So these connectors are quite extensible. You can add and remove more connectors. If you want to connect to legacy systems also, you can add authenticators or provisioning connectors, so on and so forth. So for example, I was talking about the Duo Security Authenticator. So there also we have a Duo Security Authenticator as well as a Duo Security Provisioning Connector. Because for you to connect with Duo Security and do multi-factor authentication, it's not enough that the user resides in identity server. The user also needs to have an account in Duo Security, right? So we need to have like a provisioning connector to Duo Security. So there are two ways to provision. Either the admin will go to the identity server and provision the users manually to Duo Security, but that is a very cumbersome way. The other way would be just-in-time provision to Duo Security. So when the user wants to do login, first he will login with username password, and the second factor is Duo Security login. Just before he goes to Duo Security login, we will provision him to Duo Security, and by the time he goes to Duo Security, he's already provisioned in Duo Security. So he can do the mobile authentication and come back. So this is just-in-time provisioning. So there is no admin intervention in this process. So that is very easy. Otherwise, the admin has to go and one by one provision these users to the Duo Security. So this is how you can write authenticators. So it's a simple Java implementation. You extend certain classes. You implement certain interfaces. And the beauty of it is that once you do this, not only the backend authenticator, but even the UIs will be populated based on your custom code. So that's the beauty of it. And also, without even restarting the server, it will be picked up and the UIs will be populated, the necessary fields will be shown, and you can do your authentication. So even without restarting the server, right? So this is like a dashboard we provide for the end user. So this is the dashboard in IS5. These are based on gadgets. So we provide this much of gadgets, but already for the new release, we already have a few more gadgets, especially for the DO security, the one-time password configuration, and we have a certificate authority component in the new release, so there are more gadgets. So this is very extensible. It's not only our gadgets that we ship by default, even as customers, you can write new gadgets and put it in as required. And another key feature which is coming out is the workflow execution. So workflows has been very much in demand. So 5.1.0 in 2 months' time, this is the key feature that is going to come out with Identity Server 5.1.0. So in this architecture, the default executor will be a BPEL executor, right? So the default executor will be a BPEL executor. So it's going to connect to our own WSO2 BPS engine, right? But of course, you have the freedom to write custom connectors and connect to other BPS engines, or you can even connect to other systems which are not BPS, so on and so forth. And also, what are the events that can be what are the events that can trigger this BPEL process, right? So that also is not limited. So by default, we will trigger certain events for user management operations like add user. For example, if you want to add user, there will be a process triggered, then there will be an admin who is coming and who will approve the process, and then only the user will be created. Or you want to delete user, or you want to assign a user to a privileged role. For those kind of operations, you can trigger the process. But it's not limited to that. Even any other kind of operations, for example, if you want to promote a ZACMAL policy from a PAP to the PDP, even that can go through this workflow. Or else if you want to do just-in-time provisioning, and you want to provision the user, but you don't want him to log in, even that can go through this workflow component. So it's not limited. There's a lot of flexibility here. And the key feature, and the key feature is that we don't want to make the same mistake we made with ZACMAL. So ZACMAL, we assumed people will know to write ZACMAL policies. So here we are not going to make that mistake. We are not going to assume people know to write BPEL processes. Of course, knowing to write BPEL processes is good, but we are going to make that process easy. We are going to provide some templates, right? So the templates will be populated in the Identity Server's UI. As the user, you don't even have to log into the BPS server. In the Identity Server's UI, there will be clear descriptions as to what this template is going to solve. So as the admin of the Identity Server, you will provide certain values, and that will generate the BPEL process and deploy it in the BPS server. So that's to make things easy. But of course, if you want more advanced stuff, you can log into the BPEL server and customize the BPEL processes. Another key specification that has emerged, that has come about, is user managed access, which is built on top of OAuth 2, right? So what is the key problem this is trying to solve? So if you know about OAuth, OAuth talks about four parties, right? OAuth talks about a OAuth client, it talks about a OAuth authorization server, which is in the identity server. For example, it talks about a resource owner, and also it talks about a resource server, right? So what does OAuth do? The resource owner is delegating some of his privileges to the client. So if I am the resource owner, I am giving some of my privileges to my mobile application, or giving some of my privileges to my browser, to my desktop application. This is what OAuth is trying to solve. But what is UMA trying to solve? UMA is going a step further, and it is introducing a new party here, which is called the requesting party, and that is another human being, right? So OAuth is doing access delegation from a user to a client, but UMA is trying to do real access delegation from a user to another user. So it can be my coworker, it can be my my teacher, parent, or whatever, human to human access delegation. That's what UMA is trying to solve. And the access policies can be defined maybe using XACMEL, right? So you can have policies, system level policies, user level policy, application level policy. So there are a lot of extensibility in that area. So this is like work in progress. We are working, and it's being done as a Google Summer of Code project, actually. So we are leveraging the open source contribution here as well. And another important thing is privileged account management. So we have dedicated systems for privileged account management that do very special tasks. But we see that there needs to be better integration between PAM systems and IAM systems. Especially, one of the key features that PAM system requires is password change, frequently changing privileged account passwords, right? So it can change every other session. Once you log in, your password will change the very next time. Again, you log in, it will change the next time. Or you can change it on demand. So these are some features that can be expected from an IAM system as well. So here also, we are doing a lot of work. So there are a few limitations in our current identity management space. So we are improving those as well. And also, PAM systems require timely provisioning, right? If an admin user leaves the organization, immediately that his account should be terminated. Or if he moves to a different department, the resources that he can manage should be changed. So these should be done by a provisioning system. An identity server has a good provisioning framework to do this kind of stuff. And of course, the role management is also built in identity server. So PAM has a lot of usage from the IAM system. And lastly, I think security information management system, SIM systems. So I think WSO2 platform has the required components, the nut and bolts, to build a SIM system. So we have the WSO2 DAS, basically the previously known as BAM, so which is a high-performing scalable data analysis tool. We have the WSO2 CEP, which can do intrusion detection and intrusion prevention in real time. We have the machine learner. So these three products combined could make a good SIM system. So basically, to audit identity access control data and identity data. So this is where basically the identity survey is moving towards in the coming years. Thank you.